Om tava katha amritam tapta jivanam kavi viriditam kalmashapaham shravanamangalam srimadatatam bhuvi grinantiye bhurida jana. The nectar of thy words give life to those scorched by the world. Those words which have been declared by the knowers of truth dispel our ignorance. The very hearing of them is beneficial. Thy words are beautiful, pleasing to the ear, pleasing to the heart. They are inexhaustible in the benefit they confer. Those who recount them on earth are the givers of the highest and the best. Today's scripture is the Gospel of Shri Ramakrishna. And we are continuing with the chapter, The Master and Yam. And it was recorded on September 27, 1883. So last time, Shri Ramakrishna was talking about a Hatha Yogi, Achalananda. And he didn't much approve the ways of Hatha Yogi, because that is more concerned with the body and not much to the transformation of the mind and progress on spiritual life, more concerned on body and long life, making body fit, healthy, flexible, and living longer, and no other aim. Long life cannot be the aim of life, aim of a human being. Long life with some purpose is fine. I want to live longer because then I can serve people, or I can do good to the world, or I can repeat the name of God. That should be some purpose of living longer. Otherwise, life itself has to have some purpose. Otherwise, only extending life for living longer sake and without any purpose, life has no meaning. So Sri Ramakrishna was talking about Achalananda. Now he changes the topic and he says about Narendranath, his favorite disciple, whom he really loves, and because he knows who Narendranath is. So he knows the genesis of Narendranath, the spiritual genesis of Narendranath, that he is one of the seven rishis, came specially to perform the purpose of the advent of Sri Ramakrishna. So this is a wonderful, this unity between these two souls performing a greater purpose of re-establishing the dharma. Dharma sangsthapanarthaya. So Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Vivekananda. Of course, Holy Mother's part is also very important because it is hidden, and they say Sri Ramakrishna is the inspiration and Holy Mother is the implementation. And Swami Vivekananda is the one who explained the things of what Sri Ramakrishna did. One is preaching, one is manifesting totally in life, one is the source of all the new explanation or new methods of spirituality suited to the present age. So he says to Yam, what do you think of Narendra? And Yam knows how Sri Ramakrishna loves Narendra. Yam replied, he is splendid, khub bhalo. He is splendid, that much was the answer. Now, this was enough to say someone is splendid. Sri Ramakrishna was not satisfied with this much of description about Narendranath, because he somewhere explained, if another great person, great spiritual leader of this time is like a small fish, he's a huge, large rohu fish. If he's like another person, like a small lotus, he's like thousand petal lotus. If another person is like a jar of water, he's like the ocean. Like that, he compared Narendranath because of his inherent power, which was not known and seen by anyone. Narendranath used to feel embarrassed when he was praised like that. And he said to Sri Ramakrishna, what are you doing this? What people will say, you have gone mad. Where is that person is so great, you are comparing to me in that way? People will say mad. And because you love me so much, that's why you just exaggerate my qualities. And you will be, once he said, your case may be like Jada Bharata, like Bharata, was only thinking of deer, and he was born deer. You only think of me, and because of out of your extreme love for me. That's why it's not for anything that Narayanath says. Can you say about Sri Ramakrishna? I don't know anything about him. He is just love for me. Nothing that he Narayanath felt the tremendous extreme love that he had got from Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna says sometimes that even mothers cannot love their child so much. I feel so much love for youngsters. It was Narayanath he loved very specially, but not that only Narayanath, he loved everyone. So he is splendid. Now Sri Ramakrishna says, yes, his intelligence is as great as his learning. So very intelligent, sharp, and also very learned. Narayanath that time itself had gone much beyond his books. He used to read the philosophy books and even communicate with the Hegel and all Kant and all that thing. He was very advanced in that. Learning was great and intelligence, of course. Besides, he is gifted in music, both as a singer and player. He used to play tabla, and of course he used to play sitar and also tanpura. So Sri Ramakrishna admired his music. And M also says that Narayanath's music, Vivekananda's songs were most beautiful he used to sing. Second only to Sri Ramakrishna. That's M's comment. Sri Ramakrishna's songs were incomparable. So second only to Sri Ramakrishna was Narayanath. He was so bright, so beautiful music he had. And not only in studies and intelligence, but also in other extracurricular activities. We now know that how wonderful he was in cooking, how expert he was in games. He used to play good cricket, they say. He was the hero of the community, jokes, saying things, inspiring others. So he was expert in anything that he did. So Sri Ramakrishna takes these two, his learning and intelligence and his music, these two roles. And then what he says, then too he has control over his passions. Now after his skills, intellectual skills, comes his mental power, inner power, power of control of the mind. So that, because Sri Ramakrishna saw him as adept in meditation by birth, janmasiddha dhyani. By birth he was a meditative. We know the story how everyone was playing meditation and suddenly a cobra came in the room. All those others, they were all kids, all fled away, run away from that room. Not in this bile, small bile was meditating. Why? Because all others were playing meditation, only Bile was doing meditation. He was in meditation. That because he was, by birth, he was adept in meditation. He didn't have to learn meditation. So he was already in meditation. He had some unique features that he himself didn't know. Sri Ramakrishna says, Naren, do you see before just you sleep, you see light in your forehead? He said, yes, I see. But what is that? I think everyone sees that. I see a light and when I close my eyes, it just becomes bigger and bigger and then burst. Then I fall asleep. But that's how it happens every day. Is not that common to everyone? He said that he thought is common. That's why he never told. But Sri Ramakrishna knew everything about Narayana. He never told that to anyone. But you see how he knew. Then he says another great quality, he says, he's so happy. He says, Narayanath says, he will never marry. So that also Sri Ramakrishna says, very happy. Because, you know, he had a purpose. Not that marrying is something. To Yam also he said, are you married? First visit. So he said, yes. Oh, Ramlal, you see he is married. And then he asked, and then what? And Yam says, what wrong is that? What mistake I did? Then again Sri Ramakrishna asked, do you have children? Then he says, I can feel the palpitation of my heart. What will happen now? Then he says, yes, sir, I have children. Then again, Sri Ramakrishna shouted and said, Ramlal, he was his nephew. Ramlal, he has got children also. So he thought, what is wrong in marrying, having children? It's a very normal thing. Then he was a little embarrassed. And then Sri Ramakrishna knew that he thinks that it is wrong something, so he explains, I was saying this because I see some great qualities in you, so that I was saying he would be bound in the family life or not. So that he explained. So Narendranath has some different purpose in life. You know, later on after this thing, Narendranath, he was a graduate that time and son of a lawyer and so much nice to look and all that. There was relations coming for his marriage. So, and someone said, if you get married to my daughter, I'll send you to England to study barrister, law. So like those coming, and news came to Sri Ramakrishna, he ran to Kali temple and said, mother, please help, make everything, disturb all this thing or plan, what is this going to happen? So mother used to go, ma sab golmal kore de, just make it disturb this, don't let it happen. So he went rush to Kali temple. And this was about the marriage, so it didn't happen. Now Swami Vivekananda, a tremendous renunciation. One day he comes and full of renunciation, want to renounce the world and go as a mendicant. He comes to Sri Ramakrishna and Sri Ramakrishna sees him and seeing him he understood. He's burning with renunciation to give up everything. Then Sri Ramakrishna saw and then he sang a song, I'm afraid to tell you, not afraid to tell you, I'm afraid that I may lose you, Sri Ramakrishna says. And after that, they both started crying. Narendranath also, Sri Ramakrishna also, there's a meaningful song. There were other devotees. Then they said, what happened? Why are you crying? Oh, he said, something happened between he and me. Something happened between us, so you don't need to worry about that. So this was the thing that how he changed the Swami Vivekananda, guided him the chosen path that he had been brought to this world. He had to follow and to preach the new methods of spirituality, the modern way of spirituality that Sri Ramakrishna has brought, ushered into this world by the divine will. So he says he will never marry. You know that story, sir, one person was going, suddenly it said, stop, to a man was walking. And suddenly the wall in front of him just fell down. So he was saved. So again he walked, then he was crossing the road. Again the voice came, stop. He stopped. This truck went forcefully, very fast it went. If he had gone, he would be crushed. So then he was also saved again. Then he looked up and said, who is this? He said, I am your angel. What do they call? Key angel?
Guardian.
I am your guardian angel. So then he said, oh, thank you for this. But where were you when I got married? In Hindi there is a joke, one person prays to God and God is very happy and comes in front of him. And God says, Mannat Manglo, whatever you want, ask. So he said, Lord, may I never get married. Lord says, how can that be? I asked you for a Mannat, but you are asking for a Jannat. I asked you for asking something, but you are asking heaven. So that cannot be. There are something for the suitable in the world. Maine tumko mannat mangne ke liye kaha, jannat mangne ko nahi. So like that, there are so many jokes for this all things. These are after all jokes. As I was talking about the life of householder, the married person's life is so great in every respect. So these are all jokes, means like that, which is not really the true, really true, that becomes joke. Often we joke about women, often about men, all of those are jokes, so. Yam says, you once said that one who constantly talks of his sin really becomes a sinner. He cannot extricate himself from sin. But if a man has firm faith that he is the Son of God, then he makes rapid strides in spiritual life. Sri Ramakrishna said this to him sometime and he remembers and how he brings forth now that You are a sinner, you are a sinner, so you really become a sinner. That was Sri Ramakrishna's one saying. Always think positive. They are talking now about positive psychology. Sri Ramakrishna was the greatest positive psychologist. Always think you are good, always think. You say, when you say, I am Atma, you become Atma, you realize Atma. When you say, I am good for nothing, I am good for, you will become that, Sri Ramakrishna says. If you say, I am a sinner, you will become a sinner. So don't say, I am a sinner. Always say, I am pure, Shuddhoham. Nityoham, Muktoham, say that I am free, I am pure, like that always you say, I have gained the wisdom, then you will gain that. So positive psychology, always fill yourself with good thoughts. And just relate that what Sri Ramakrishna has said, if a man has firm faith that he is the Son of God, then he makes rapid strides in spiritual life. I am a son of God. Sri Ramakrishna often said, what sin can touch me? I am a son of mother, divine mother. How can I be bad? So this thought itself gives so much purity. This thought that I am son of divine, I am divine. Swami Vivekananda also always said, think that you are divine and all purity come. Always he said, assert your nature as the Atman. Ever pure, ever strong, immortal, all-knowing, all-blissful Atman that you are, assert that again and again. That is what saying is, having faith in yourself and asserting that, your true nature, Master. Yes, faith. Because what tremendous faith Krishna Kishore had. Now he gives the example of some person who had so much faith in oneself. You see, Sri Ramakrishna often said, Vishase milaye bostu, vichare bahudur. It was a saying that if you have faith, you will reach God. And if you want to rationalize about God, think about the God, whether he exists or not, then he will be far away. You will not get him just by reasoning. But with a faith that he is there, God is there, you will reach soon, quickly. What tremendous faith Krishna Kishore had. He used to say, I have spoken the name of God once. That is enough. How can I remain a sinner? Very much Sri Ramakrishna's ideal. He so much quoted this. Once I have said the name of God, that is enough. How can I remain a sinner? And that he said once he had gone to somewhere in pilgrimage, and on the way he was thirsty and he found a well. And one person was bringing out the water, pulling the water from the well. He said, can you give me water? I'm thirsty. He said, oh, no, I can't give. You seem to be a higher caste person. I'm a lower caste. I cannot give you water. What do you say? Lower caste? Just repeat the name of Shiva, Shiva. You say, Shiva, and give me water. Then everything becomes pure. You become higher caste. That was his faith in the name of God. His tremendous faith in the name of God that it can purify. You know the story that one rishi was there. He has tremendous faith in the name of God, saying the name of Rama once can remove all the sins. So once he had gone out and some person did something, happened something wrong by that person, he came to the rishi. Rishi was not there that time, his son was there. And he said, by mistake I committed this wrong, and how can I be absolved of the sin? What I need to do that? The son said, he knew his father. He said, don't worry, have with faith, and with the promise that you are not going to repeat such actions, just say Ram Ram, and you'll be free from sin, whatever you have done. And the person went away. Evening father came, son told all the things, and father will be happy because he had prescribed the same thing. No other thing needed. No other Purasharan, Godan, taking deep in Ganga, giving so much of in gold in this thing, no other thing, any other purificatory thing is not needed. Just say Ram Ram. So son thought he would be very happy, told that I said this prescription I gave. Father became very angry. He said, why asked you to say Ram Ram? Son said, what did I wrong at you? Only once Ram will do. Why two times Ram? One time if you say Ram, he is purified. No need of second Ram. Repeating Ram's name second time. That was the power of name of God. Once you repeat, once you say, but it has to be done with faith. That is the thing. If you do not have faith, even 108 times Ram's name will not do. If you have faith, once it is done, it will be effective. And he said, How can I remain a sinner? I have become pure and stainless. One day, Haladhari said, even Ajamila had to perform austerities to gratify God. Can one receive the grace of God without austerities? What will one gain by speaking the name of Narayana only once? So that Haladhari said in presence of Krishna Kishore, who had so much faith in the name of God. Then, after this comment, at these remarks, Krishna Kishore's anger knew no bounds. He became very angry. The next time he came to this garden to pick flowers, he wouldn't even look at Haladhari. Because what faith you have? You lack faith in the name of God, and so you have to do austerities. You know Ajamila's story that he said the name of Narayana at the deathbed and he got liberation. That is the story. But Sri Ramakrishna explained that it's not only by the name, he did so much of tapasya at the beginning, that's why it was effective. So he must have heard this, Haladhari must have heard or read this story, that's why he said, Ajamila had to do practice, even had to do austerity, only name didn't do. So this thing, Krishna Kishore doesn't want to say that, name with faith, it is enough to do that. Haladhari's father, now Sri Ramakrishna talking about some great, what he has seen in the people. Haladhari's father was a great devotee. At bathing time, he would stand waist deep in the water and meditate on God. People go to bathe, they have seen in the Ganga or some river, and they take a dip, stand there, and generally they offer water to sun. That's a general custom they offer. When it is cold, sometimes take deep and they run away. I have seen one person, I had gone to Kedarnath, and it was summer time, but water was very cold. It's, you know, Kedarnath water, it just ice melts and it becomes water, 0 degrees in Celsius water temperature there. So one person said, I will take a dip in that river near Kedarnath that flows. And he was determined to do that. It was a little cloudy day also, a little windy. So he went somehow with all generosity, all braveness, courage, he went, took a dip, one dip, and the cloth was lying on the bank. I was standing there, I didn't take the dip. And he came the way he ran from there. I remember this fast forward in TV. You have seen the fast forward? He ran that speed, which cannot be explained, not double, triple. He ran as fast as he could. It was a fast forward on the TV. That much cold if you have, where you will do stand on the deep west water and meditate? No question. But sometimes that also happens. But Haladhari used to meditate in west deep water, you see. And how much he meditate? Sometimes many people do little japam, and weather is good, India is mostly hot, so there's no problem. Many do japam, some do offer water to spirits, to some people they love, and to sun god, or to their Easter, they do that. He would stand waist deep in water and meditate on God, uttering the sacred mantra. Then the tears would flow from his eyes. Haladhari's father was such a devotee. Repeating the name of God while bathing, tears will flow from his eyes. So how much sincere was his prayer and his meditation. Here's another incident. One day, a holy man came to the bathing place on the Ganges at Ariyadaha. There was in the gospel reading today about Sri Ramakrishna's father going to take a dip in the pond nearby, and how he was poor, he was deserted from a village, and his own home, he had to give up everything, came as a refugee in another home, another village, with the benevolence of one of the friends. And so poor he became very poor. But you see how people respected him, that when he went to take deep in the water, all others will get up so that it remains for him. And when he went past on the street, the shopkeepers and all would stand out of respect for his character. We often say only money brings respect. It's not money, but the character. He was so truthful that he sacrificed everything, all his property, all his wealth, all his possessions for the sake of truth. That type of thing we hear in Ramayana. Ragukula Riti Sadachali Ayi Prana Jai Varu Vachanana Jai. You have given your promise, you have given your words, that you have to keep that. Truth has to be followed. Even the life can go for that. You can die for that, but words should not go in vain. Whatever you have said, it had to be done. So that was Sri Ramakrishna's father. We read in the Ramayana, there are so many things incident in the human beings, all these great qualities hidden. If we had not read the gospel or Sri Ramakrishna would have not told, we would not know about there are so truthful thing person that they can give up any position for the sake of truth. And such people are there now. Once someone said to Sri Ramakrishna, oh, perhaps now in the world there are not many great sadhakas are there. Sri Ramakrishna, why? There are so many people, good people, real, sincere, spiritual aspirant, evolved souls are there. Why you say that? When you don't find around yourself. That he used to say, there are people, very good, elevated souls are there. God realized person also are there in the world. It's not that only you find only when you read. So otherwise humanity will be lost if good persons are not there. With their power of spirituality, the world is retained in its place. The whole humanity survives because of some good people's good work. One day a holy man came to the bathing place on the Ganges at Aryadaha. We talked about seeing him. Haladhari said, what shall we gain by seeing the body of a man, a mere cage made of the five elements, Jnana Yogi, an Atma? What is there in the body? It is the spirit that is important. So what is good in going to see a person, just a cage? That he said in front of Krishna Kishore again. When we see a holy man, we approach a holy man, do we approach just to body? Or this body of a holy man and the body of an ordinary person are same, because all both have the same life process. So is there any difference between the body of these two spiritually different level persons? That's the question. If you analyze, it is same biochemical reactions, same panchabhuta. That is all about the analysis of a jnani or a scientist or a non-believer. You will say it is same. Then Sri Ramakrishna doesn't say his comment, he says what Krishna Kishore did. Krishna Kishore heard about it and said, what? Did Haladhari ask what would be gained by visiting a holy man? By repeating the name of Krishna or Rama, a man transforms his physical body into a spiritual body. To such a man, everything is the embodiment of spirit. To him, Krishna is the embodiment of spirit, and his sacred abode is the embodiment of spirit. He also said, a man who utters the name of Krishna or Rama even once reaps the result of 100 sandhyas. With faith it is done, you don't need to do. When Sri Ramakrishna himself says that Gayatri, Sandhya merges into Gayatri. When you evolve spiritually, Sandhya is the evening prayer that you do. Now, when you have become more advanced in the spiritual life, then you need not do Sandhya, it all drops off. And you do only Gayatri, because in Sandhya there is many things, then you do the real mantra japam. So only you do the start doing the Gayatri. And when you still evolve, Gayatri merges into Om. Then only Om you say and done. Even Gayatri is not repeated, his repetition is not necessary. And then finally the Om merges into Brahman. Then you need not repeat any mantra. You are always in the awareness of Brahman. This is how the spiritual evolution happens. That's what Sri Ramakrishna says. And this Haladhari also says, Krishna Kishore saying that body of a holy man is just cage of five elements. He doesn't know it's so different from others because he has practiced sadhana. He repeats the God, that was sadhana for Krishna Kishore. He repeats or she repeats the name, God's name. So it is different. It is the whole body is full of consciousness. It is Chinmaya Dham, Chinmaya Shyam. If Shyam is full of spirit, so
the place where Shyam sits, that is full of spirit. So when this great spiritual person dwells in that body becomes very so different from other things. That's why when Sri Ramakrishna touches, there's a different effect. It's just, if you see, it is just a touch. So how can this be different? So whole body is so different from others if you see spiritually. Not only that, where Sri Ramakrishna lives, where Chinmaya Shyam, Chinmaya Dham, even the Dham, the place where he lives, where he dwells, becomes Chinmaya. And that it becomes holy, it becomes powerful, it becomes is the power to energize you spiritually, inspire you spiritually. It doesn't happen only during that time. If the power of the spiritual person is great, that spirituality remains there forever. You feel that when you go to Varanasi, you feel that when you go to Dakshineswar, you feel that when you go to Vrindavan, Kailas. How do you feel that? It's the same earth, but so different from other places. You go to Kedar Badrinath, you feel so different, that remains there. So that power always pulsates there. It's quite palpable for the people who visit those places. I've seen people in Bethlehem when they went, they were emotionally so much charged, those Christians visiting from all over the world. They started crying, shedding tears. Where Jesus was born 2000 years ago, 2100 years ago, and after that they go and they feel the presence of Jesus there, because of that holy association, that Chinmaya Sham, Chinmaya Dham, that becomes as holy as Jesus. If they would have met Jesus, they would have born 2100 years ago and had met Jesus, they would have the same feeling that time. And when they go there, they really feel Jesus, that place. So that's what the Chinmaya Dham, all this. Even the place becomes surcharged with the spirituality of that person, and he's saying body is nothing. Body is very much spiritual. How this association with something becomes very important. Not only spiritually, even the things you see, they say Sachin Tendulkar, great player. The bat he played, it becomes some valuable thing. It will be sold in lakhs of rupees, auctioned. Why? It is like any other willow bat. But because it was associated with a player which is there, so it has a different value just by mere association. He touched, he played, and if it is done century, this prices go more. If it is the last game, it goes more. But this association with some important person has some place in our mind that affects us. It becomes for that person something worth keeping. It's valuable than even the diamond. That becomes that. Its value cannot be understood by other, but the one who is lover of cricket knows the value of the bat once played and touched by Tendulkar or Gavaskar. Like that it happens. And for one who is spiritually inclined, for anything associated with spiritual great persons is important. And people feel that. When, not that one who takes the Tendulkar's bat which can play like Tendulkar, he will be playing as he knows, but for a spiritual person, when he visits the places where it was associated with his deity, they feel that aura in them, they feel that feeling comes. It's more powerful than just mere excelling in the worldly pursuits, like cricket or knowledge or any other thing. So that is more a subtle and more powerful as it can be felt. People go to Vrindavan, and that to feel the power, you have to have something inside. Some purity has to come. Sri Ramakrishna went to Vrindavan, and he started crying. Everything is like you, Krishna. Where are you? I cannot see you. That was the welling power to meet Krishna that came. He felt so wonderful. He went to Nadia and says, where is the feeling for Chaitanya? It's not coming. He toward that place, Navadvip. And nothing of Chaitanya was came. So I should feel something. So once he was going by boat there, then he feels that two persons are dancing and they are coming towards him and merge in his body. He felt, oh, the original Navadvip might have reversed, turned the course, and it was in there. And how you know Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? He found out Vrindavan. He was going to the forest. Vrindavan was not known. story is in Bhagavatam. But where is that Vrindavan in the long history at all? He went there and he had a strange revelation, spiritual revelation. And he said to his disciple, Rupa Goswami, go and stay there and develop that place into pilgrimage. That is where the Sri Krishna was born and his lila was played. He could fathom that, the right amount of that transmitting power and receiving power, right receiving. When we have, we feel that. Now, talking about Krishna Kusha, Sri Ramakrishna says, one of his sons chanted the name of Rama on his deathbed. Krishna Kishore said, he has nothing to worry about. He has chanted the name of Rama. So it was a big shock for that person. His son dying, putra shok. But he was so happy that he chanted the name of Rama, so he will go to highest heaven. That was a great consolation for him. But now and then he wept. After all, it was the death of his own son. The son, the greatest grief in the world is the death of one's children, one's child. That's why Sri Ramakrishna, that mother of Baburam Maharaj, Swami Premananda, when Sri Ramakrishna said, after Haladari left Dakshineswar, he said to mother of Baburam Ghosh, that who became Swami Premananda, he said, can you give your son to me? He's so pure. Only he can hold me when I'm in samadhi. Otherwise, I cannot bear the touch of any impure person. He is pure unto his bones. Even the bones are pure. He's so pure. Can you give your son to me, to serve me, to help me? Mother said, the mother was devoted. Mother said, yes, of course. You are asking, how can I say no? I will gladly, my son will be here. That will be my greatest fortune, greatest joy. But someone doesn't give her son like nothing for nothing. I have two conditions. So what are the conditions? Sri Ramakrishna asked. One is that I must always remember you. I must never forget you. Always I should be devoted to you. And second condition, no child of mine, I should never see the death of a child. My sons. That is two conditions. Because that is, she is so devoted to Thakur, to God, that she doesn't want anything else. But still she knows the pain of separation is so big, so shocking, so deep. So I can't bear that grief of if that happens. And you know, that time was there were no medication and people, death was so uncertain, not like here, expecting 80 years, 90 years, 120 years. That time, some disease happened, no antibiotics were there, no medicines were not there. So something happens and you just die anytime, 20, 30, anytime people used to die. So death was, when it comes, it was very uncertain. But now rather we say, oh, there are treatments, medicines are there. So why that person died at 48 years of age, we say. So not that everything is not there. Still the Yama has a rule. He can take anyone at any time. So, but it's less expectation of death. That time it was because of lack of medication, so any person can die anytime. So she said that none of my children should die before me. Sri Ramakrishna said, yes, of course. And both promises were kept. Sri Ramakrishna kept and he came. So though he was such a devotee, but still that have. And we hear in the life of Yam, who could even conquer this, even weeping now and then is not said, but when monks visited when his daughter had died, he could behave just normally as if nothing had happened. There would be very deep pain, but he could, by the power of Sri Ramakrishna and by the power of his wisdom and conviction of that the soul is run by God and everyone belongs to God. Why we have so much grief when our children die? Why we have less grief than others' children die? Because we think they are ours. They are not ours, this minus is there. Otherwise every child dies and we feel the same pain. It doesn't happen. Because that we think is mine. But when you understand that no one is mine, it's all gift of God. Everyone belongs to God. And it's God's thing given to me, and when He wants to take away His thing up to Him, He has lent it. He has not given forever. He has just lent it for some time. Someone He had given for 20 years, someone He had given for 80 years. It is up to Him how much He had given, we don't know. So He had given, it was His property, He took back when He needed. So it is up to Him. Why should I worry for that? When you have the feeling that your children don't belong to you, but they belong to God, then grief is less, you can control. But that is also very difficult to really convince yourself because of God-given attachment, you see. So much attachment God gives in our heart. And Sri Ramakrishna said that is also necessary, otherwise who will take care of the children? If there is no attachment and feeling of mine is, the child has to be reared. She has to be taken care of, nurtured. So with that attachment of mine is, then you nurture. So that is very fine. But once they become of the age, then we should be always reminding that my children, though I say mine, were all gifts of God. They belong to God. Nothing is mine. Even this body is not mine. Everything belongs to God. That idea if we can impose on ourselves. So our wealth is God's, our children are God, even this body is God. So then when little separation is there, something happens, then less pain will be there. Otherwise, either they leave and we feel shocked, even they are not, why to talk of death? When they go away, there is great shock. Our children go away, sometimes go away not just out of something and great pain. Or if that doesn't happen, we have to go away before them. We say the age-wise, we grow old earlier than them, and then we die. That time also will be pain. I am leaving you. You are leaving me as much painful as I am leaving you. So if we do not consider the thing that everything belongs to God, then the pain will come. If you don't want to have that pain, that shock, always reminding ourselves that everything is God's, nothing is mine. One Bengali song, this Shyama Sangeet, mother's song is there. Ami amar nai janani kichui nai amar bhutale. Nothing is there that is mine on this world. E brahmando tomar srishti. This whole universe is created by you, O mother. Drishti hine amar bole. Those who call my, they are blind people. Those who don't have understanding, those are deluded, they say it is mine. So always to say, everything belongs to God. And this, to affirm this again and again, is the time of the prayer. Lord, may I have no attachment to anything in this world. May I have to wisdom to understand that everything belongs to you. And you are the owner of everything, not I. Nothing whatsoever is achieved by the performance of worship, japa and devotions without faith. You do everything and then, isn't that so? Sri Ramakrishna. Yes, sir, that is true. Now he says some very interesting incident. Master is speaking. I see people coming to the Ganges to bathe. He says how people behave in a different way. I see people coming to the Ganges to bathe. They talk their heads off about everything under the sun. They have come for some holy act. The widowed aunt says, without me, they cannot perform the Durga Puja. So much of ego. I have to be there. Without me, nothing can happen. I have to look after even the smallest detail. Again, I have to supervise everything when there is a marriage festival in the family. Even the bed of the bride and groom. So everything lies on me. Without me, nothing happens in the household. So I am that important in the household. This saying, if we analyze ourselves, we also often tend to think that way. Without me, this will not happen. Without me, this will not be intactly kept. That is the thing. You'll be surprised. I spoke with an ordinary housewife whose husband died 2 years ago. And she was just talking to me, and she said to me, Swamiji, I was to get, after that happened, she was alone with two daughters of hers. And she said, I used to be always worried whether the door is locked or not, whether my daughter reached college in time or not, how will she be coming, always worried of what is going to happen, always. And I was in the verge of getting sick. Then I thought, why am I getting worried so much? There is God, there is Thakur and Ma, who will take care of everything. Then I totally gave up and surrendered myself to the will of God. Now, Swamiji, you will not believe, I don't worry for anything. I am very happy, and really she seemed very happy when she spoke to me. I am not worried at all whether the fire will catch or they will come return in time or not, whether she will get bus or not in the winter. I don't worry for anything, and everything is happening as it should be. It should happen. And she said one nice thing. Not that by God's taking care everything will happen good. She didn't say only that. She says, if God wants this candle, I don't blow out the candle going away. I said, you should not go that much. But she said that so much faith in God. If God wants, fire will happen. What can I do? It will cause fire. What can I do? But I have full faith in God. It will happen as God's will. When one has so much of faith, then God is bound to protect that person. And she seemed to so free and happy person. And I praised her and she said, Swamiji, what to do? I was so much worried for every minute details. All took on myself. And then I thought, this is not the way. There is someone who takes care. Why should I be worried? I have become totally free and the life is going on as usual, beautifully, happily. I am also happy that things are also in order and totally dependent on God. So that is the way that one should think, that God will take care. Who am I to think about that? If we think too much of ourselves, that this is mine, I have to take care, too much given, little responsibility, okay. But everything, I want to make my child like first in the school. My son should be first, that is in India. And when somehow he became second or third, then mother becomes very sad. What happened? The son was interested in music. You see, the son wants to sing. Mother says, no, you have to become first in the class. Grade 8 student. And family tradition is all are musicians. And son is in that way, wants to see music. And he started learning music. And that time, he became third in the school in one terminal. So mother becomes so sad, so she was committing something wrong because my son became third. My son has to become first in the class. That position, because he's my son, she has to listen to me. I want to make him first in the class. I want to make him an engineer. Like that thing, we often think that way. When it doesn't happen, then you get frustrated. You impose your own wishes on someone who perhaps is not interested in that. You don't give him freedom, curtail the other person's freedom of your son and daughter, cripple his growth, and yourself get worried. So this is sometimes possession and trying to guide our own children as if we are responsible to make that according to our whims and wishes, forgetting that there is some higher power who guides everyone of us. Whereas we also couldn't become what our parents had expected of us. So what about that? That we don't consider. I have to make what I want to my son. Little inspiration, fine. That's why they say, you do your duty, inspire them to be good, to have good academic career and all that, but leave the final thing to God. After that, my duty finishes. Now prayer, and finally is God. Karmanne vadhikaraste ma phalesu kadachana. You have the right to work, to inspire, to suggest, but final doing, phala, is God will give. So when we have that, then we are at peace. When Sri Ramakrishna said about the people who go for sacred work, like bathing in Ganga, still their mind is not at all there, and this aunt talks about only about I. Yam says, why should we blame them? How else will they pass the time? So Yam supports them. Now he has stopped seeing blame in persons, you see. It is all influence of Sri Ramakrishna. And what Sri Ramakrishna says, Master with a smile. Some people, this is still continuing. Some people have their shrine room in their attics, at the top of the shrine room. The women arrange the offerings and flowers and make the sandal paste. They're doing all arrangements for puja. But while doing so, they never say a word about God. The burden of the conversation is, what shall we cook today? I couldn't get good vegetables in the market. That curry was delicious yesterday. That boy is my cousin. Hello there. Have you that job still? Don't ask me how I am. My hurry is no more. So all saying about I and me. Where is God? And you are working all for God's sake. Where is the thought of God? What will happen to this person if Sri Ramakrishna was in like Rani Rasmani's place? Rani Rasmani was sitting there not talking anything like this, but was thinking of her lawsuit. Sri Ramakrishna goes there near them and slaps her on her cheek. What will happen to this person? And Sri Ramakrishna has heard this, is not the story that he is making, creating this thing, literature. It is his own experience that he just remembered and is relating here. So we often do that. We don't have to see this story. We often do that only the reminder that when we are, these all are, have some meaning. You see, M was trying to say, justify, or not to see the blame, but Sri Ramakrishna says this to remind us when we are in the temple working for Thakur, do you remember, we remember God or something else? What will happen to that, this, that, and mine going here? Then that work will not be that beneficial. M. Yes, sir. It is so in the majority of cases. As you say, can one who has passionate yearning for God continue formal worship and devotions for long? So what M wants to say, because they are still engrossed in worship and puja, so they are not, they have not yet developed the passionate love for God. So that's why again he says about that will happen, it's quite natural to talk about worldly things, and it happens in majority of the cases. So what gospel shows us, like a lamp, like putting the finger, this is the majority of the cases that do that, worldly people, that's why they said worldly. Are we among these, or are we trying to be different from the crowd, different from the majority of the people? Are we able to think of God when we work in the shrine? Are we able to think of God when we go to our workplace? Are we able to think of God more often than earlier than previously? Are we progressing in our spiritual life? That to remind us, Sri Ramakrishna wants to show that. Match yourself and fit yourself. If we still think, I have done this, I do this, without me nothing will happen. And not only saying, maybe we do not say, but we feel. You know, how do we make the difference that we feel that I have done and saying that it God has done? I am nothing. It comes from praise and blame. If someone criticizes what you have done, then you feel very bad. Though you didn't never say that, oh, it's I who did this. But in the mind you're always saying. If someone says, oh, it has been done so beautifully, then you say, oh, what I do, it's all God does. But inside you are just swollen up. You are popped up. My mind, you say, that taste comes when someone criticizes you. It's very easy to try to digest the praise. You react that way. But someone criticizes, how do you react? So, no, you didn't do bad. It was not really a good thing that happened. Then if you can remain calm and not disturbed by that, then you say you are not the doer. Otherwise, it is very difficult to put your ego and work and detach. You know, to work something, ego is needed. I am doing that, that feeling comes. Because we are not established in Brahman. We have the ego that I am working thing comes. That as in the fifth chapter it is said, whatever is being done, the knower of truth sees that is not being done by himself or herself. Only senses work in the sense objects. Hand is working to do something, eye is doing, seeing something, but I am not doing. Only yukto manneta tattvabit. Only tattvabit, knower of truth, knower of Brahman can do that way. We are not in that state. So what we can do? When we work, little ego. Yes, I am doing that. I want to make it beautiful. After that, detaching from the work. Lord, it is done all by your will. So do the thing and detach that I am not the really doer. So who did that? It was all done by this body and mind, by your inspiration, by your guidance. So it is that way. So if one praises, not I didn't do anything, it's God's will that So it is all up to mental thing. Spirituality is something we have to practice inwardly. Someone blames, someone says criticizes, then also calm. What do I know? I did all as you tried. That person was not happy. That's fine. So then we become resigned to the will of God and understand the truth that I am not the doer, you are the doer. Sri Ramakrishna, that mantra, Naham, Naham, Tuhu, Tuhu. Not I, O Lord, but Thou, but Thou. So in everything, if we can say it's really the God is the doer, He is the achiever by His power. If I have achieved something, it is achieved by Him, then the ego doesn't work. And when the ego is put in its place, then we are at peace. When ego becomes bigger, means it's just swelled up, it becomes strong ego, then there is trouble for us. And when ego is, we are very egotistic, we bring trouble for us and also we create trouble for the world. So being, trying to be spiritual, trying to be prayerful, we want our ego to be in its place, to its size, cut the ego to its size. And we want to serve God, serve the children of God, and have peace inward and generate that peace outwardly. Swami Ranganathanji said very nicely about, do you know what is the test of spiritual progress? He said that, do you feel that, there's a beautiful quote, I didn't bring that. So, do you feel that it is God that is doing the work? And by doing the work, do you find peace within your heart? And that peace, that peace is manifested itself as meditation inwardly and the loving service of the world outwardly. So when we have that peace and purity of heart attend to the spiritual progress, we become peaceful in heart and we have greater joy in prayer and meditation. And also, we become more of free service, loving service to all, without judging others, without seeing defects in others. Always trying to say, this person is that, this person is good, this person is bad. So that means we are not progressing. We have to be always careful. Swami Vivekananda used to say, when you find some defect in others, this person is not good, that person is bad, then cry, weep, and say, why still I find defects? So I have not progressed. Because everything happens by God's will. Why I should judge another person? That should not be there. The more we evolve, more we find only joy and good in others. We gain the power, it becomes so strong to absorb if anything is happened that is not according to my will, that which I think is not the right thing, that also we can absorb that and it doesn't disturb me. So that is the sign of spiritual progress. When we can adjust with the world as it is, we can adjust it very well in a very loving, peaceful manner. That is the sign of spiritual progress. Thank you. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat Shri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu Jananim Saradam Devim Ramakrishnam Jagat Gurum Padpadme tayo shritva pranamami muhur